own version of that.
So anyway, it was back 1985.
Is it time? Is it time?
It's time. I'm going to start the blow dryer story.
Yeah.
And the people here are lucky enough that I may actually show what's left of the blow dryer damage. It was... but it was 19...
That's why you've been wearing that stovepipe hat, isn't it?
It was about 1986, and we had been up until, you know, many people think that Penn & Teller started around 1986. We had actually been carny trash since about 74. We've been playing all over. We played Renaissance festivals. I'm admitting it. Since I'm going to get very personal here, I can let all the skeletons out of my closet. After I went to Clown College, which you also went to, I then teamed up with Teller. And we went to, we did Renaissance festivals.
I did all those,
Every sort of street performing you could possibly do. Just, and incidentally, made a ton of money. You know, you make a ton of money street performing. And since I'm no longer street performing, the statute of limitations is over, I can say to the IRS, I was making about $5,000-$6,000 a week cash. Absolute cash money street performing and declaring none of it. Because I went to an accountant and I said to the accountant, you know, I make this much money. And I guess I should declare it and you know, pay taxes on it. And the accountant said, if you declare that much money from street performing, you'll be arrested instantly as a drug dealer. So you made a lot of money.
I made a lot of money street performing, yeah.
You're not going to say how much.
No, I'm not going to say how much.
No, because you're afraid that IRS will pay attention.
$2,000 or $3,000 a weekend, you know, easily. So.
And so we had been
traveling. And it was great because you have that bags and bags of $1 bills.
Bags. And it was like a stripper. You know, strippers go in and buy the new Mac computer with $2,000.
That's us.
Oh, wonder what she does for a living, you know, with the aftermarket. First of all, get breasts. The stripper thing? Yeah, you're going to want to have breasts, first of all, to start.
It actually would help your juggling as well. Yeah. I don't know if you knew that.
And I had a girlfriend back home, used to juggle topless, looked like she's doing five. It was an optical illusion, of course. That was a joke told by Tommy Curtin, who was a juggler in the... You know Tommy?
No.
Yeah, he told that joke every time someone came up and said, hi, Tommy, I'm a big fan of yours. He'd say, I have a girlfriend back home, used to juggle topless, looked like she's doing five. It was an optical illusion, of course. And that's all. That was his idea of social interaction, which is what jugglers are. So it was 1986, and we were playing. We'd just gone off Broadway, and I had a girlfriend at the time whose name I will not say because some of the stuff that will be said during this is actionable. But we had we owned a house together in Southern California.
So there are records.
We
can check the records if we needed to.
And there's a whole story about how she stole my house, but that's a whole other story. Because I don't know many people that had a house stolen from them. But believe me, that's not as amazing as what you're going to hear in the blow dryer story. So we had made this wonderful relationship idea. Because she was going to stay in Southern California. I was going to go to New York and be off-Broadway. And then if we caught on off-Broadway, she was then going to pack up the house, sell it, and move to New York to be with me, okay? But when we hit New York, things started moving very, very quickly, and phone calls were fewer, farther between, and we started to drift apart. And I didn't give a good goddamn about her. I was all done with Southern California. The relationship was completely and utterly over. Until... she said, the relationship is over, and I have never loved anyone more in my life. It's exactly true. Don't put your head down like that. How many times have you done that? You know, I just, yeah, four times. I really did not care if I ever saw her again. She said, this isn't working. We're breaking up. I love you. Christ, I love you more than anything. So she moved out of the house that we lived in together and did this other thing. Now, none of this is weird yet. We've all been through all of this. She then moved in with the friend that she had who hated me the most. You know how you do that during a breakup? You find the friend that hates
right.
your ex the
I
most.
I never liked him. Hey, we're best friends.
So this was a lesbian woman who was a full-out, no kidding, diesel dyke, you know? And she, it was great because she hated all men. She hated all entertainers, and she hated me more than those two things together. She just loathed and despised me, and they had one phone. This is in the days, 86, before cell phones, or, you know, when cell phones were the size of a town. So you didn't have that. So to call her, I had to call her through this lesbian who hated me and would just hang up the phone on me. So, I mean, there was no way to get through, and she would have... you know, occasionally call and leave message on my machine. I hate you, I hate you, I hate you. So she was an ex-girlfriend and done and move on and we're out of it, no problems. Except you're dealing with Penn Fraser Jillette. So I decided that I had to win her back. I knew how I was going to win her back. I had to fly back and see her in person. Because once our eyes met, and once she saw that love in my eyes, and how powerful the love was, she would fall back into my arms. Yeah. I was going to fly like a movie, like a bad movie.
Are you sure you don't drink?
I don't drink. No, there was no drinking involved in this.
Okay.
These were sober decisions. Yeah. We were doing 8 shows a week off Broadway. We were dark on Monday. So I had 2 shows on Sunday. So I could leave Sunday night with the time change, get in at about 11 in the evening, right, win her over, and then Monday... I have to stay there, and then Tuesday fly back for the Tuesday night show. Now, when you're off Broadway and you have no understudies, you're really kind of not supposed to go away 3,000 miles during a one-day break. But I was going to do that. I was going to win her back, and that is the start of the blow dryer story. We'll be back right after this. That's good bass playing, isn't it, Jonesy?
I never heard anything like it.
That's Mike Jones' big band playing. Hey. My wife just went out for a second. She brought in a bunch of cupcakes. I can say this on the air. You know, we paid for these? We paid full price for these cupcakes. So I can say that. It's not any sort of payola. Cupcake Lane Bakery, which is just opening here in Las Vegas, has brought us over cupcakes. And the great thing about them is that they have... copies of the Hostess cupcakes with little swirls on the top. And that's a thing happening in all the fancy restaurants now, is they have really expensive versions of comfort food.
Yeah.
You can go to restaurants and spend like $12 for a Twinkie.
It's great, you know, isn't it?
And they have like those Kobe sliders and all that stuff. I mean, really expensive food that's made to be comfort food, made to look like cheap food. And that's what they have here. The cupcakes are astonishing. There's all sorts of different flavors. And we're in the middle of the blow dryer story on the Big Penn Jillette Show. 866-570-PEN. 7366 is the phone number. PennRadio@gmail.com. PennRadio.com. So. Penn, our hero. Call me my hero. I only change from hero at the end of this. I'm pretty heroic up until the very end of this. So,
just call yourself the Penn.
The Penn.
The Penn.
The Penn decides to fly. Now, the producers, who our show was doing really well. We were on Saturday Night Live. We were on Letterman. Things were going fabulously. The show was sold out all the time. And all of a sudden, one of their little trained monkeys they put into a theater has decided to fly back to L.A. So they're very unhappy with that. But I finished the show, you know, run to the airport, and I have got like, Wayne! I've got graduate fantasies in my head. I mean, it's going to be the most beautiful thing ever. And I just know when I go there, it's going to be beautiful. And I also know that she's just going to leave her stuff at the Dykes apartment and just come right with me back to New York, where we'll live happily ever after. I mean, this is going to be wonderful. So I'm on the airplane, right? And I bring very little stuff with me because I know I'm flying right back. And it's going to be fabulous. And I'm on the airplane, and I fly across. And this whole thing is just that kind of jacked up feeling you get, that's this combination of love, desperation, hopelessness, Diet Cola, and a show off Broadway.
Lack of sleep, yeah.
All those things together. You know, and I've done, remember, we did, at the time I was off Broadway, we were doing 2 shows Friday, 3 shows Saturday, 2 Sunday. And each one is like, what's that?
Was that the one on 42nd between, like,
11th and 43rd, between 9th and even earlier than that. Yeah. Okay. West Side Arts Theater. Did you see us there?
I did.
It was a good show, wasn't it?
It was awesome.
Yeah, thanks.
Did Penn look a little
tired?
Saw,
you saw that? How many people saw the show?
Well, off Broadway.
Woo! You didn't see the show off Broadway, did you?
Me?
Yeah.
I was born in 1980. But I was born because the show.
You were conceived in the
lobby.
Ladies' room of the Penn Jillette Theater. So I'm on the plane, and I get in at 11, and I go. I go over. I'm gonna. Let's call her Mary because
why not?
When I need a name. I go, and Mary will not pick me up at the airport. She is wisely against me flying out, but she says she will give me an audience. We will be able to talk. But she says, I don't know what the hell you're flying out for, because this is not, nothing's going to happen, really. So I get in about 11, whenever the flight got in. I get into a cab, and she was living in Orange County. So from LAX, it's this long, you know, a two-hour cab drive, an hour and a half.
Is this Minnie Mouse?
What's that? Minnie Mouse.
Minnie Mouse, that's who it is, right?
Minnie Mouse is who I was dating. We get down. I get there. I go to the door, and the lesbian is going to sit there and hate me. It's her apartment. She has a right. But she's decided. It's this little tiny apartment, right? And Mary, or Minnie, I guess we'd call her Minnie. Minnie was in this back room, not even really a second bedroom, but the back room of the lesbian's apartment, right? And there's this one kind of kitchen dining room. That's all there is. It's pretty much a one-bedroom apartment. So I walk in there. There's no sort of comfort. She's sitting there like, this is my apartment. Which it was. Hard to argue with her on that. This is my apartment. You shouldn't be here, which is also true. So at this point, she's right about everything, you know. And I walk in, I got my leather jacket, you know, I'm in my heavy Ramones phase. My hair is really short, you know. I got sneakers on. It's just, I'm totally, totally cool, right? But I'm totally cool in a way that a lesbian in 1986 would really hate you. It's just disgusting. You know, my glasses are tinted. It's everything is bad. So I go in there, and then I sit in the living room with the two of them. It goes very badly, you know, because this whole thing of opening the door, having her there, look in my eyes, fall in my arms, and we go to the, you know, the airport, Hyatt, spend the night there in wild sexual bliss, and fly back to New York. Well, that's already not happened. That part of the plan is...
Did she go to the other team at that point?
No, I don't think so. I don't think there was any lesbian activity going on.
Yeah, of course you don't.
Subsequently...
What's that? Of course you don't.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
How could that be?
Subsequently, I've imagined that. I don't believe so. At least it was presented that way. And the setup of the apartment was such that it really looked like it would have been easier for them to live if there were sexual activity in a better living arrangement. And they certainly weren't trying to do show pretense to me. I believe that, you know, she was telling me she was dating other. She was telling me anything she could to get me to stay away. So I've now discovered that I'm a lesbian, which is a technique that was used by an earlier girlfriend. That technique didn't work that well, but it worked okay. I didn't care at all about her. Then the second she broke up, boom! I was driving back to San Francisco from about, you know, never mind. Whole other story. So I'm there, and then we decide to that we're going to go into her room, which I see as a really good sign. And the lesbian storms off. I mean, the mouth that she hated me was just, it was dripping off her. And I really do believe, in fairness to her, that there are men that she would have liked. And I want to say that all lesbians are... man-haters, because they're not at all. I don't think she was a man-hater as much as she was a Penn Jillette hater. She loathed me, and I believe for really good reasons. I believe she thought he didn't care about you at all until you split up, and now he cares about you desperately. I believe that was her argument. I believe she was right about everything. So the absolutely correct lesbian goes into her bedroom for the night because she worked early in the morning. Important thing, okay? There's one bathroom here. This is where the blow dryer story comes in. There is a blow dryer in this story. Eventually. We go into this back room. Yeah, eventually. We get there eventually. In the back room is where Minnie is staying. And she's staying on like a couch futon that's kind of goes out to a single size bed. We're going to go in there and talk. okay? And we talk, and I cry, okay? And I cry a lot, and she cries a lot, and we talk about the good times that we had and how important it is. All of a sudden, it's working. It's really, really working. And it hasn't gone exactly the way the scenario on the plane said, but it's going okay, okay? So we now have to, it's now time to go to sleep. It's about, you know, 3 or 4 in the morning. And she says, you know, you can sleep here with me because, you know, the lesbian does not want you in the living room. But we're not going to do anything. Nothing's going to happen. And, of course, I almost believe her on this. But they're still holding out some hope. We get into this tiny, tiny bed where we are touching, okay? And we are not naked, you know, but we are just in our underwear. It's a really sexually charged situation. We haven't seen each other in about 6 weeks. We've been crying together. We're madly in love. We're just, you know, inches apart on our face. Our bodies are actually touching. We're there. The lights go out, and she falls asleep in, like, maybe 35 seconds. Like the Navy sleep deprivation experiments, you know. She just sleeps, and she sleeps, and I don't even think she's faking.
Yeah.
Although, you know, I think...
You know, I'm your only friend here. She's a very good actress.
I have no doubt she started out faking. But I believe her interest in me is so low that it actually went to real sleep. Okay. I do not sleep a wink. And I have not slept the night before. And I am in a room 2 inches from her, and I can't sleep at all. So I'm there in bed stiff, and I don't mean in the sexual sense. I mean just not being able to move. And I lie there, like I believe, we'd have to have John McCain on for this, but certainly much worse torture than it was ever done in Vietnam to our servicemen. And I have great respect for all people who went through this. This is certainly much worse than the tiger cages or any of that punji sticks. This is much worse. And I'm there for like an hour and a half, 2 hours, and it's horrible. And she's sound asleep, and if she's faking, she's on 2 hours of faking. You know, 2 hours of deep, deep, deep faking. Great, commit. What's that?
Long fake.
Long fake, exactly. Long fake. Who was not there? He's a juggler from China. And so I decide, and I have this also ties into the bathtub syphilis story, which I'm also not going to tell here. But there have been times when I've spent up to 12, 13 hours a day in the bathtub. I find the bathtub very comforting. And for a while, I used to, whenever I had meetings with Teller, make him come into the bathroom, and I would lie in the bathtub. I had a setup so I could use my typewriter in the bathtub. I ate in the bathtub. And I found solace there in the fact that when I talked, I sounded like John Lennon. And there's a certain kind of womb-like atmosphere that always helps. No matter how bad things are in my life, if I go into the room and take a bath, everything kind of fades away. Everything's okay. So I decide to get up and take a bath. That's my plan. And I'll tell you, even in hotel bathtubs, where it's like, for me, it's like a sitz bath, yeah. You know, and I don't fit in at all, I'm still okay. If just like my butt and my lower back are in hot water, and I can look up at the ceiling, and then it can go cold, I'm fine with it going cold. And what happened was I was in baths enough that I was doing the show in San Francisco, and a nurse came up to me, and I had these marks on my arm, like these little rashes. And this nurse came up to me and said, Penn, I enjoyed the show very much. You have second stage syphilis. I can tell by looking at your arms. And I said, no, I don't think I do. And I went to the doctor because she said she insisted that I do. And the doctor said, oh, you have second stage syphilis. Let's start treating you. I said, I don't think so. And they said, well, there's nothing wrong with having syphilis. I said, no, I don't think I do. Do a blood test. I came back. I didn't have syphilis. I went to him and he said, I have to ask you some pretty personal questions. What about your hygiene? And I said, there's no problem with hygiene. I'm in the bathtub 12 hours a day. And he said, you've destroyed your skin and given yourself phony syphilis. You can't take baths anymore. And I said, Oh, no, no, that's not an option. I need to take baths. I can't exist without baths. He said, okay, no more than an hour a day, and you have to use bath oil. So when you go upstairs, the reason there's bath oil by our bathtub is not because I am a homosexual, but rather because doctor's orders to not get syphilis, I need oil in the bath. So I'm going to head in and take a bath that night, ever with the blow dryer story. This is Penn Jillette, Free FM, CBS Radio. We'll be back with the rest of it. That's the Mike Jones Big Band playing there. Jonesy's in the room here. Jonesy's in the room. We're talking about the blow dryer story as promised on the one-year anniversary of Michael Godot and Penn Jillette on the air, CBS Radio. If you ever wondered what Free FM stood for, it stood for telling the blow dryer story. So she is sleeping in the room, and I decide that I'm going to go into the bathroom because there will be the bathtub. I will lie in the bathtub. It's about 4 in the morning, so I'm safe. You know, the lesbian's not going to get up for a while. I can have an hour and a half bath, kind of soothe off, and then go back. And I'm even thinking maybe I'll sleep on the floor in there. Once I have a bath to calm my nerves, I'll be okay. So I go in, and I see something that I guess to other people is not terrible. But I walk in the bathroom, I see there's no tub. So I'm not going to be able to take a bath in the bathtub. So I'm just like, oh, no, no. And then I say, shower's okay. Shower's what men do anyway. Bathtub is a girly thing. This will be a new experience for me. I'll take a really hot shower at 4 in the morning. Now, the lesbian's room is directly across the hall or beside the bathroom, and I don't really remember which. But I know she's very close, and I know that if I wake her up, she'll kill me. And I don't mean that, you know, colloquially. I mean, she'll probably kill me. And so I go in there, I take my clothes off, and I get into the shower, and I take a really nice hot shower. And I'm thinking, this is pretty good. Hot showers are pretty good. Take a nice long hot shower. I'm thinking, will there be enough hot water for the lesbian? Oh, yeah, it's only 4 in the morning. Boom, boom, boom. And I finish up, and I pull back the shower curtain, and I look, and there are no towels. No towels at all. And I've come in with just my underwear, you know. I haven't brought all my clothes in. I can't even dry myself off on like a T-shirt. And also, I haven't brought a change of clothes because I'm going to take her back to New York to live happily ever after. I'm not moving to L.A. I'm not moving to Orange County.
Toilet paper before?
Well, I have dropped a ton of the toilet paper. That's where the story is going. So there's no towels. There's not even a little hand towel. There's nothing. The lesbian has taken all of those away. So I open the door very quietly to the bathroom, and I look around, and I see there are two doors. One of them has behind it a lesbian, and one of them has behind it perhaps linens, towels, and so on. So I get down. I am now butt-ass naked, and I'm on my hands and knees looking under the crack of the door to try to see if I can ascertain lesbian or linen. Lesbian or linen. I can't. So I go back in, and I kind of push the water off me, and that's not satisfying. So I look over, and there is a blow dryer. And I go, I never used a blow dryer. But if it's good for blow drying the hair, it could be used in the whole body. So I go over to the blow dryer, and I plug it in, and I turn it on, and I put it on high and hot. And I take that thing, and I turn it toward my face. And it is terrific. It is really terrific. Like nothing has ever been terrific before. It is terrific. And I go over my hair is short at that time, over my ears, and then inside your ear that has a little drop, it's getting dry. And the other ear, and I'm going, wow, this is amazing. And I go down, and I blow my feet, you know, and they're between my toes. I'm spreading my toes, you know, in that leftover monkey gene that allows you to do that, and spraying the blowing the blow dryer between them. And it's drying my toes. Like they, now, I'm not good at drying myself off. It's not my strong suit. But now it's fabulous. And I go up my legs, and I go on my back, I'm drying. And now it's been probably 15 minutes that I'm blow-drying every inch of my skin, right? And the blow-dryer is hot enough that I'm kind of holding it down by the end. The whole thing is heating up. And then I decide, well, let's dry those up really good. How's it pronounced? Perineum? The perineum, which is also called the taint, right? Also called the taint. I put the blow dryer on there full blast, and that place is dry on my body, I believe, for the first time since birth. It is just real, and I mean, it's really dry and velvety and puffy. It's just the greatest perineum there's ever been.
The moss is dying.
And now, my little wrinkle is just water free. It's just great. And there's like, it's powder fresh. And I'm screaming to myself, I'm the Louis Pasteur of hygiene. Why doesn't everybody do this? Why haven't they always done this? This is terrific. And then I say, now it's time for little Houdini. Now it's time for little Houdini. And I say, wait a minute, the bottom side of little Houdini, where he touches his two friends, is never completely dry. Never, ever, ever. You, no matter how much you towel dry that, there's a little moisture. So I grab little Houdini.
No, you're not facing your wife. You should see the look on her.
I grab.
Nice cover.
I grab little Houdini. Okay, and is now gone to white hot. You know, it's just you know, the filaments are just melting. And I'm holding with just the tippy tip of my finger on the tippy tippy tip of little Houdini and the blow dryer underneath it. And at that moment, there's a noise. And I believe it is the noise of the lesbian opening the door. And I'm going to be caught taking her blow dryer and blow drying a male penis. So this frightens me, and as I turn, I let go of little Houdini. I let go of little Houdini. It slips out of my hand. And little Houdini goes, and I'm proud to say that, you know, that safety margin they have, which is a couple inches on the top of the blow dryer?
Yeah.
I'm proud to say that my little Houdini reached in that easily. Of little Houdini goes directly on the white hot filaments of the blow dryer. And it makes a sound. As it hits. And like a hamburger on a grill, it sticks. And there's the smell. There's the smell of burgers roasting in the backyard that is my little Houdini now attached to the grill of the blow dryer. And I go, pop! But I realize there's a lesbian in the next room, so I can't do anything. And I'm pulling and pulling, and it finally goes. And now, you know how Wendy's had that char-broiled thing? That is of Burger King, yeah. It's the checkerboard. But I'm not concerned about that. I'm concerned of the smell of the burning in a lesbian's that's on her hair dryer, right? So now I turn it down, and now I'm taking her nail file, and I am picking little burnt pieces of little Houdini out of her blow dryer, picking them out, and I'm banging it against there, trying to get the little pieces out, right? And I finish that, and I put the blow dryer down, and now I'm standing there, and I look at little Houdini, and it is now blistering over the whole tub. Yeah, this is bad. So I put my underwear on really quickly without thinking about it, and I'm fairly dry. So I open the window to the outside of the bathroom so that the smell of hamburger goes out, and I go back and I get into bed with Minnie. I fall asleep.
Aren't you in terrible pain?
I get up. Yeah. Unbelievable pain. Unspeakable pain. But I fall asleep. I get up the next morning, and the lesbian has gone to work, and I'm sitting there, and my ex-girlfriend is cooking us breakfast, and things are just really, really terrific. And it is exactly like it was in the movie. It's beautiful. We have breakfast. We have the apartment to ourselves. It's beautiful. I have my underwear on and my jeans over it, right? And then we sit on the couch, and she starts making out with me. And then she reaches over and puts her hand toward the zipper. And I say the most horrible thing you can say. I grab her wrist and say, "We have to talk before you do that." And she says, "What?" Because she's sure I have some horrible disease. And I said, no, it's nothing like that. It's nothing like that. It's very, very simple. And I tell her, she's the first to hear it, the blow dryer story. And I believe that the blow dryer story is going to be okay for her. I finish the blow dryer story, and she goes, "Show me." And I go, no, you don't want to see it. Burger King and the blisters, and there's not even really a hole there anymore. And she goes, "Show me." So I drop, says, "Get out of here." And I go, "It wasn't my fault." She says, "I want a normal life. Things like this don't happen to other people." Big screen and television. 1 year. That's the blow dryer story.